Okay, I was cut off before. I wasn't watching the time, but now we're back. And I was telling you about how when you're in internal commercialization is the way of exploiting the strategy you're using to exploit the innovation, then of course you have to do everything yourself. But we have this whole range of different strategies, so let's look at them. So from internal commercialization, right, to internal commercialization to licensing. So with licensing, you're kind of giving up almost everything. You're just saying, here's the idea. You're letting someone have the invention, and you're saying, here, just take it and you produce it, market it, you sell it. And just let me take some percentage, some fee. So it's really small risk, but it also quite limited returns. If you have a very strong patent position, though, you can be in a driver's seat, more or less. You can negotiate better because if it's very strong patent protection, the company that wants to license it, they may be hungry to produce it because they know it's a great idea. And if they're not able to get around the patent, which is not really typical, to be honest, most patents are overcome within a few years by other research and development efforts. But if it's a very strong patent position, the licensee can be in a stronger position to negotiate. Could also outsource certain functions, right? They had these complementary resources, but maybe we can outsource sales, distribution, or manufacturing, do contract manufacturing. So it limits the necessary investments, but we are then dependent on suppliers and partners. We can do a strategic alliance, and there's some benefits of more flexibility. There's different types of alliance structures. And then, the risks are, of course, if it's a bit less formal and it's less contract oriented, people are kind of jumping into the same pool or, they're kind of in the same boat, let's say, and everybody's depending on each other. But if we don't specify by contract who's responsible for what, it gets a bit messy. Joint ventures, we make a very clear new company where we both share in the investment and the risk. There's some risk of the partner conflict or clash of cultures, especially if it involves global partnerships or global, different joint ventures from partners from different countries. And then, as we said before, internal commercialization gives the biggest risks and the biggest rewards and allows complete control. Resource requirements, as you can imagine, ranges from very few, very little, and on the other side, substantial resource requirements. And here's some examples, Ericsson with the Bluetooth technology licensed it out to, I think I thought it was Sony, but I could be wrong. Dolby Labs licensed out its sound, sound reduction technology. We have a joint venture between NBC and Microsoft and formed MSNBC. And we've got, Larry Page and Sergey Brin partnered up to form Google, and they internally commercialized all those ventures. And Dyson commercialized his own, innovation in vacuum cleaners. You probably have seen that. But if you don't know the Dyson vacuum cleaner, or they have also fans and blow dryers and things like that, I would recommend taking a look. It's kind of interesting technology. So let's move on. Now, we talked about lead time being important. If rivals can imitate, if there's no strong patent protection, let's say, then time lag is the innovator's major advantage. It's their biggest friend. If they can get ahead of the curve, if they can use that time well, then it's then they can take advantage of and get the most profits out of this innovation. But maintaining lead time advantage requires continuous innovation in terms of the product and the process, so that using the lead time well means building a strong market presence, as we said before, exploiting the learning curve, the economies of scale, getting better at manufacturing so you have more knowledge and know-how, increasing quality. And then also this continuous improvement and continuous innovation, incremental improvements. Like, think of Apple with the iPhone and with the iPad, right? They started off with relatively simple devices, but they've just consistently got them better, smaller, faster, stronger. And it kept the product, interest in the consumer's mind. So, and also process innovations, like in manufacturing technologies, getting, better quality, more efficient production, cutting costs, eliminating unnecessary waste. All those things go into profit, which can be used to further, exploit, build strong market presence, build strong brands, make customers, build their loyalty. So, this lead time is reinforced by learning effects. Again, learning effects are things like exploiting the learning curve, all the things I just talked about. So if you're the innovator, right, imagine that, sales are on the left and time is on the bottom. So the innovator is farther along the curve than the followers. So the followers are trying to play catch up. The innovator, they're exploiting these economies of scale, right? They're already farther along, but they've got to use that time wisely. So this is one of the main ways of protecting, or I should say, appropriating the value of an innovation. Interestingly, the things we talked about, patents, trademarks, but let's say patents, lead time, complementary resources, things like that. These are mechanisms for protecting the profits, the value of innovation. And this survey was done in 2003. It was published, but it was on these different industries: the drug industry, biotechnology, computers, and semiconductors. These are the numbers of companies, and there's 37, so 37 companies in the drug industry, 19 companies in biotechnology, 33 companies in computers, and 24 in semiconductors. And the survey was on, they asked the managers in these companies how effective these various mechanisms were in protecting the value of an innovation. So first of all was this, remember we talked about the tacitness, things like secrecy, right? The number one, the secrecy was highest in biotechnology, okay? But if you look comparatively, patents were much lower in biotechnology. Lower also in drugs, and substantially lower in computers. And then if you look at semiconductors, it's almost half the value. So secrecy, patent protection is not so strong in many of these industries. Just keeping the trade secrets, the tacitness of the technology is important. Lead time is also the most important thing in many industries. Like look at computers, lead time, exploiting that lead time is really important. Much more important than patents. And in semiconductors, it's also much more important than patents. Not as important as secrecy in the semiconductors, but it's still more important than patents. Even, the lead time is more important in drugs. Not as important in biotechnology. Complementary sales and services is also important in terms of computers, right? Having complementary sales and service is higher, has more protection, stronger protection mechanism for profits than even patents. And then complementary manufacturing was also considered to be more important, slightly more important in computers, reasonably stronger, much more important in semiconductors. So patents here, you can see it is not the main strongest thing in most of the cases, right? The other protection mechanisms are important. And again, this is another survey, US managers' perceptions of the effectiveness of different mechanisms for protecting innovation. So when it's a process innovation or a product innovation, here we see that lead time is the highest, it's the strongest, most important for products. It's also the most important for processes. And again, moving quickly down the learning curve, and then complementary resources like sales or service efforts is, actually the most important for products, complementary sales and service. So you see, here, patents were not that strong, right? You see that how low they are, especially patents for securing royalty income or to prevent duplication was not that strong. And then finally, here's the last, again, this research results. The green numbers just show the highest percent. The red numbers show the lowest percent. And then blue is somewhere in the middle. But for product innovations on the left side, just look at the left kind of group of boxes, if you will, product innovations. For the industries, like on the left side, food, chemicals, drugs, computers, electronic components, telecom, medical, and across all industries, what do you notice? Patent protection is among the lowest in all of them, right? Out of all the groups in all industries, across all industries, on average, it's the lowest, 35%. The highest is lead time, right next to it, 53% said that it's the, these are the most effective way of protecting the innovations. Secrecy is among the highest, lead time is among the highest, and again, complementary manufacturing, if you look at electronic components for product innovations. For process innovations, it's really about secrecy. And again, patents score really low on this protection as a protection mechanism. Secrecy is the highest. Okay, so then the issue was, is it, we asked this question before, for the strategic management of technology, is it better to be a leader or a follower? So, some of the important things to consider, we'll examine these in a bit more detail. So the first thing is, can the advantage be protected by intellectual property rights or lead time advantages? So can this innovation, is it protectable? Remember, like this is the regime of appropriability strong, either through patent protection or other property rights, or through lead time advantages. If it's strong, if it's a strong regime of appropriability, then there's advantages, as you might expect, in leadership, right? Being first. How important are complementary resources? This is a tricky issue. If complementary resources are really important, sometimes followers can be in a better position to wait and allow the innovators to establish the necessary infrastructure. For example, think like in the frozen food industry, how much investments were necessary to bring frozen foods to consumers. Now, you may not think of it now, it may not be so easy to think of. Actually, I'm running out of time, so let me just come back to that example in the next video, okay?